the thing that caused us to be must be outside of time. And yes, of course, in a second.
I just want to expose you how hypocrite you are.
In a second, I'm just addressing this man's question.
I'm going to expose you.
This man is ignorant. This is the Dalit. This is the Dalit.
Don't be physical. Don't be physical. Don't touch me. I'm going to expose this.
The
this hypocrite idiot. I'm going to expose him.
So you can expose me now. You can expose me now.
Yeah, yes. I wanted to expose your hypocrisy. The hypocritical level you have.
Go on then.
First of all, a small point. Last week, you say
Islam is the best religion in the world.
No, except that it failed.
Yes,
we know that.
Okay. I'm not having a debate with you, but if you want to have a debate with me...
No. I'm going to make accusations. You're going to have to stand up for it.
No, listen to me. I'm not having a debate. Yes, you can come back to me.
Of course,
no problem. But if you want to have a debate, we can have a proper debate next week if you want to, where we choose the topic.
So, God, you're going to...
So, your two points of hypocrisy, you call yourself Christian,
yes.
Which in short meaning, follower of
Jesus.
Christ. Yes. Now... Jesus tells you if he hits you, somebody hits you on the right cheek,
yes.
Offer him the left.
Yes.
I saw your video the other day. You say, if somebody will punch me, I'll punch him back.
Yes.
So isn't that a hypocrisy that you call yourself a follower of Jesus Christ, but you're doing the opposite of what Jesus tells you? That's the first point.
Okay, that's
second,
the first point.
Second one, I watched another video of yours a few weeks back. You're talking about the slavery.
Yes.
Yeah? Islam, slavery, and you ask Muslims questions.
Yes.
You Muslims, what do you think about the slavery? Is it a good thing or bad thing?
Yes.
And the Muslims say it's not good.
Yes.
You said your conscience is better than your Muhammad,
yes.
And Allah.
That's right.
On the other hand, when you come back in Christianity, now what has to do with slavery? You say there's no more slavery and you give the worst. From, I think, Timothy, if I'm not wrong,
yeah.
Paul says, free the slave. Yeah, I'm paraphrasing. He says, free the slave. I can take out the words if you want. So my question to you is this. When you accuse Muslims, or you say Muslim, your conscience is better than your God and Muhammad, then why don't you realize the conscience of Paul was better than Jesus and Yahweh? Why? In 31,000 verses, nowhere you find that Jesus or Yahweh abolished slavery. So to me, it's a double standard and it appeals to hypocrisy.
Okay, so my response to that, firstly, let's be clear about what the word hypocrite means and where it comes from.
Oh, right.
Sorry, do you not want to listen to the answer?
I'm not as educated as you. Now you're going to play around the word of hypocrisy.
No. So, firstly, let's just be clear. Let's just be clear. I'm quite happy to admit on camera.
I can open the dictionary. I'm as educated as you.
There are times when in my life I've fallen into hypocrisy. I'm a human being and
you
I'm
mean last week. You
so I'm going, if you can shut up for a second and just let me speak about it. Yeah. So in terms of the hypocrite, Hippocrates is where the word comes from. It's Greek, and it was a term for theatre. A Hippocrates was a mask that an actor would wear to demonstrate they're containing one persona over another. So a hypocrite is someone who pretends to be one thing whilst being something else. Now, I publicly just admitted that there are times in my life where I fall into hypocrisy. I've publicly admitted there are times in my life where I sin, and I still do. So I don't think that there is an equivalence between hypocrisy and not being perfect. Someone who is addicted to any kind of drug may recognize at an intellectual level it would be better for their life to be free of the addiction without being able to be so. That doesn't make them a hypocrite, it just makes them imperfect. Now, to address the allegations directly, not that I'm particularly concerned about ego, but let's just talk about my understanding of the faith since that's been what's brought up. Christ talks about turning the other cheek. Christ himself, when he was slapped on the cheek, he didn't turn the other cheek.
I was going to bring
Christ himself did not do that. Christ himself, at turned to his slappers and said, "Why do you slap me?" In other words, he challenged the people that slapped him. He didn't just take it and go, "Oh, slap me on this one as well." So Christ himself, who went into the temple and fashioned a cord of whips and then used those whips in the temple to drive out the money changers, was not a pacifist. This phrase, "turn the other cheek," was hyperbole in scripture, and it's part of a whole bunch of hyperbole phrases. It was a common trait of Christ's teaching to use hyperbole, as in you take an extreme example to demonstrate your point. The point is not to take the extreme example as literal, but to understand the point that Christ is making. Christ, for instance, commands that a man should rip out his eye and cut off his hand. I don't think Abbas is going to stand here and say Christians should do that literally, and I've never been in a church that says you should. Why? It's because hyperbole. Well, you can correct me in your turn. It's hyperbole. Why? Because Christ is making a point that if your eye causes you to sin, that if something is causing you to sin, take it out of your life. It's a radical form of discipleship. That's what it calls you to do. So an example would be, if you can't use the internet responsibly, get rid of the internet. So that's that kind of thing that Christ is teaching. When he says turn the other cheek, he's not being literal. He's not saying be a pacifist. What he is saying, though, is don't allow your heart to be governed by revenge. That is what he's saying. So it's not hypocrisy to understand Jesus' correct and proper teaching. Now, as understood by the church, just for your information, Abbas, for 2,000 years. So, what was the other point you accused me of hypocrisy for? Slavery.
Slavery.
Yeah. So, the fact of the matter is that the Christian faith, precisely because of the teachings of the apostles and the prophets, which is what our faith is built upon, Christ himself being the cornerstone and the church being the pillar of the truth, has taught that slaves should pursue their freedom whenever they can, that slaves who are Christians should be treated not as slaves but as brothers, and that those who take slaves, kidnap people to take them as slaves, are listed amongst those who go to hell. Now, with that basis, the early Christian church fought against Roman slavery. And this is centuries before Muhammad. Centuries. And by the 5th century, slavery had all but been abolished in the Roman Empire. By the 14th century, slavery had all but been abolished in Europe. That is not my
query. That is...
No, I'm talking about slavery.
No, we are not talking
about
slavery.
He's accusing me of hypocrisy. Because in Islam,
you're going off topic.
In Islam, slavery is codified in the Sharia. So now let me ask you a question. Is the buying, the selling, the treatment, and the freeing of slaves codified within Sharia?
You're going off topic. Look, remember what I said to you. You ask Muslims, do you think slavery is good?
Yes.
And they say no. Then you said, you made a point on that, you build your argument on that. You say,
yes,
your conscience
is better than your book.
Than your God and
yes.
Muhammad.
Yes.
Yeah, that's what he said. But then later on, you told us in Bible, teaches us not to have slaves, free them. And who you called? Paul.
Yes.
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 So my question is this: why you didn't quote Jesus,
okay,
or Yahweh?
Yes.
That what Paul says, abolishing the slavery. Okay. Why you didn't quote them? Because there is no.
Oh,
quote.
You answering the question now?
Yes, I am.
Oh, sorry, I thought you were asking me a question.
Then you can refute.
Yeah, of course.
You can refute
course,
me.
Course.
You can refute me.
Of course.
This
of
is
course.
What my understanding.
Yeah,
is. Yeah. If I'm wrong, correct me. Because there's nowhere in the Bible Yahweh or Jesus abolished the slavery. So according to your standards, since Muslims have better conscience than Muhammad and Allah, then Paul has better conscience than Jesus and Yahweh.
Yep.
You must either, unless you agree with that, if you don't, then you're a hypocrite. That's a double standard.
Okay, so allow me to refute this point. Because Muslims, particularly members of the Dawah team like Abbas,
thank
always,
you very much. I'm proud
always,
to be a Dawah team member.
I know you are.
It's all
always,
going.
Always,
all the time.
Always misrepresent the Christian faith.
They give us
they straw man the Christian faith. They mischaracterize the Christian faith. Because the Christian faith is built upon the teachings of the apostles and the prophets. The prophets point to Christ. the apostles, as N.T. Wright would describe Paul, are the first interpreters of Christ. The Christian faith does not make a distinction between Christ's teaching and the apostles' teaching. The apostles' teaching is the correct continuation, the interpretation of Christ's life, death, resurrection, and ascension. That is how the Christian faith works. So I have no problems accepting Paul's teaching. Paul's teaching is authoritative to me, as are all the teachings of all the apostles. Now, in terms of these kind of arguments that I've had with Muslims, if you would listen to those debates carefully, and I think you probably did, you would also know that one of the key verses that I used to construct my argument is Christ's teaching about do unto others what you would have do unto them. Now, would you agree that that is Christ's teaching?
According to the Bible, yes.
Right. Now, if I am following that maxim, since I don't want to be made a slave, does it follow that I should oppose those ideologies that make for slaves?
You can make that argument, but what I'm saying is why Christ didn't say it plainly, like Paul said it.
I am going to ask you again.
That can have many different meanings.
You know,
that could have a context.
Abbas,
when Jesus says that, there may be a context.
Abbas, that of course there was a context.
Yes.
Of course there was a context.
You can't
the
really
context,
generalize.
The context was this, that someone came up to Christ and they said, good teacher, what was the question? Which is the greatest commandment? And Christ said that you should love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your mind, with all your strength, and you should love your neighbor as yourself. And then the guy says, and then tell me, good teacher, who is my neighbor? That's the context. Now, Christ's teaching, love your neighbor as you love yourself, flows into the teaching of do unto others what you would have do unto them.
Don't play this love thing.
It's not, no, it's not.
If you're going to bring love,
no, notice,
I'm going to bring hate.
Notice.
Don't do that.
Notice, Abbas wants to confine the structure of the debate to suit his argument.
You're bringing everything into
it. I am bringing my faith into it because that's what's being inquired of. Now, I'll ask you again. Is it logical? Is it a logical flowing out of? That if I live by the principle that I should do unto Abbas what I would want Abbas to do unto me, that if I do not want to be made a slave, I should oppose those who want to make Abbas a slave.
You can't generalize it. No,
you don't agree that follows. You don't think that follows.
You're generalizing it.
How would you interpret this? How would you interpret doomed unto you? How would you interpret that?
You're going off topic right now.
No, I'm not.
You made earlier a point that what Jesus says about the other cheek. You said what?
It's hyperbole.
It's not hyperbole. Because I'm going to work the context telling us
go
it's
on.
Not hyperbole.
Go on.
Because that's what I wanted to get to you. Luke
yep.
chapter 6.
Yes.
Verse 29. I'm going to read verse 28 to 30. And it is not hyperbole, it's literally.
Let's just get to that chapter.
Chapter 6, verse 28 to 30. I'm going to read three verses.
Chapter 6.
Yeah. This is definitely not hyperbole.
Go on.
Bless those who curse you. Pray for those who have abused you. To him who strikes you on the...
We mustn't call the Holy Spirit a liar. When you passed by...
Do you have Holy Spirit?
I was preaching.
Do you have Holy Spirit?
You called me a liar.
Do you have Holy Spirit?
Can I prove it to you?
You don't have Holy Spirit?
You are wrong to say
Do you have Holy Spirit?
You are wrong to
Answer
say
Answer me.
That.
Do you have Holy Spirit? Yes or no?
You are wrong.
Do you have Holy Spirit? Yes or no?
You blaspheme
Did your Holy,
Holy
Spirit tell you Jesus
you
is divine?
The Holy Spirit.
Did your Holy Spirit tell you Jesus is divine? If it does... Then
yes, he does. The Holy Spirit does tell us Jesus is divine.
Then it's an evil spirit I'm
yes,
telling you right now.
Yes, he does.
There you are.
Yep.
Okay, anyway. To him who strikes you on the cheek, offer the other also. And from him who takes away your coat, do not withhold even your shirt.
Yes.
Give to everyone who begs from you, and to him who takes away your goods, do not ask them again. How are you telling me this is hyperbole when it's literally telling you if somebody take away your coat, even give your shirt as well, somebody give you on the right cheek, offer him the other. You're just making it up. You're playing with the words here. It's not hyperbole.
No, it's not. It is most certainly hyperbole. And we know that
Who says that?
We know that Christ uses hyperbole for the example that I gave. the example
this
of cutting
verse is not hyperbole. We're talking about this verse.
This verse is hyperbole. Christ is using an extreme example.
Can't be more literal.
Do you want to just keep interrupting and have a monologue, or do you want a dialogue?
Tell me somebody.
So, no.
Some scholar of
am going to continue the answer that I want to give, not the answer you want. So, the point is, Christ is using all of these examples. All of these examples. These examples are by their nature extreme examples. The idea that you would give your shirt to someone who's asked for your cloak would leave you naked, would leave you cold. The idea that you would turn your cheek to someone who's just slapped you and offer him again, these are extreme examples.
Why did he say that?
Christ uses hyperbole to jet. There we go. That's a much more intelligent question I've asked.
No problem.
Why did Christ do that? Yes. Christ was using that to sort of encapsulate the spirit that should define the disciple of him. A spirit of generosity, a spirit of compassion, a spirit of forgiveness, a spirit of peace, a spirit that is demonstrated by self-discipline, a generosity of heart, a hospitable character. These are the reasons why Christ used hyperbole. Why? Why? Because the Jewish audience to whom Christ was speaking had been brought up with the traditions of Moses, of the Old Covenant, and Christ was establishing a new covenant. And in the Old Covenant, it was an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. You take my bag, I take yours. I give you my cloak, you have to return it to me before the setting of the sun. That is Old Testament law. So he was making references to these Old Testament paradigms and then filling them with new meaning, just like he filled the wineskins with new wine, because he is establishing a new covenant, a new way of being human. That is why he was using hyperbole. Yes, of course. Okay.
Now, let's say for the sake of argument, he's right.
I am right.
Jesus is talking about... Jesus is talking about hyperbole, not literally. Remember, Christians, never again, ever use this against Muslims, that you Muslims fight back and kill. But our Jesus told us, somebody hit you on the right or left. Don't you Christians ever use that against Muslims, because you heard from Bob. This is hyperbole, not literally. But Bob is true Christian, according to him. He follows the teachings of Christ. Anybody punch him, he'll punch him back. So don't take a higher ground, higher moral ground towards against Muslims. Never ever use that. I agree with you.
So let me just deal with this
point. So we clear that.
Let me just deal with this point about what Abbas is making.
Okay. I agree with you.
In the Christian faith does not teach pacifism. And I've stated that again and again and again. And those
Christians
that want to argue,
that
it does,
love your
do
enemy.
Not... We do love our enemies.
Hate your mother.
Right, can we...
Hate your mother. Jesus,
are you just going to heckle, bro? Are you just going to demonstrate the lovely etiquette
heckle,
of the Dawati?
You heckle
this
in
is
a truth,
always,
as a truth,
this is always the Dawati etiquette.
It's okay.
I will talk, but you will not.
Sorry.
So, the point of the matter is, Christians do not follow pacifism. When Christ went into the temple, John chapter 2, and he fashioned a cord of whips, and he drove out the moneylenders, no one in their right mind would describe that as pacifism.
Exactly.
However,
yes.
However, there are far, within a Christian paradigm, within a Christian matrix, there are far fewer avenues towards violence than we see in the Quran. Because the Quran states to go and fight the unbeliever because they don't believe. There is no such verse like that in the New Testament. None. So Christians are right to say, they are right to say that Christianity is a more peaceful religion, because there are fewer avenues by which we as Christians can justify the use of violence. It's harder for us to justify the use of violence within our faith. It's more difficult. So there is a moral high ground. Because Islam, because of the teaching of the book, has shown through 1400 years of Islamic history that Muslims have a propensity to invade lands that are not their own. Abu Bakr did, Uthman did, Osman did, Ali did. And they did it because of Muhammad's teaching. Syria was Christian when it was invaded by Muslims. Palestine was Christian. Egypt was Christian. North Africa was Christian. Spain was Christian. Turkey was Christian. Armenia was Christian. I don't need to take lectures about hypocrisy from someone standing here trying to present his faith as peaceful as mine, when anyone who is a fair studier of the two books will realize that it is not.
Okay,
can you want to reply? Of course you can.
Are you use the verse in the Quran?
Surah 9.
Kill the people of those who do not believe. Can you finish the verse?
Yes.
Because it's important, because you must, we all know that half-truth is more dangerous than a lie. So I want him to finish the whole verse.
Okay, I'll read
then
it.
He will, then he expose himself. What he says is actually not what he says.
So this is the one that I quoted, Surah 9, verse 29,
yes,
as translated by Yusuf Ali. Okay? Listen carefully to the conditions.
Very carefully. Actually.
Very carefully.
Yes.
Fight those who believe not in Allah, nor the last day, nor hold that forbidden which hath been forbidden by Allah and his prophet, nor acknowledge the religion of truth. Did you hear that?
Carry
That's the
on,
reason.
No commentary, carry on.
Fight them because they don't believe the religion of truth or acknowledge it. Even if they are the people of the book, which is the Quranic term for Christians and Jews, until they pay the jizya with willing submission and feel themselves subdued.
Yes.
That word subdued can also be accurately translated as humiliated. So, what do you got to say about
that? Yeah, I'm going to answer that.
Go ahead.
I'm just looking at some verses. Okay, you understand this whole verse is telling us? Basically, it's giving a description about the people who's supposed to pay jizya. And the description of those people are those who do not believe in Allah and the Messenger. Description comes first, and the reason comes after. I mean, those who do not believe in Allah and the last day, even though they were given the scriptures. And
doesn't say that.
Well, my Maududi's translation I'm reading, yeah?
Go on. Yeah. So we got two translations by two Muslims, they don't agree. Carry on.
You can go with your translation.
Yeah, let's go with this one.
Don't play cheap shots here.
No, we're not cheap shot. This is important.
Yeah, yeah.
This is important. He's saying it's a cheap shot. Yeah. The fact of the matter is there's over 106 translations of the Quran into English, and they contradict one another.
You see, he knows the point I'm making is going against him.
Go on.
So he's just trying to... Look, what did I say wrong here? We shouldn't be here.
You said, even if they've been given the scriptures.
Yeah. Though they were given the scriptures.
Right, it says
so,
here.
Hang on a minute.
Go on.
Are the Jews and Christians given the scriptures or not?
What is it? It doesn't say that in this translation.
Well, what is the lie about Jews and
Christians? It doesn't say that in this translation.
Christian? Okay, I'm...
It says, we can acknowledge the religion of truth, okay, even if they are people of the book.
Can I say it? People of the book, scripture.
It doesn't say anything about even if they've been given the scriptures.
Same thing, brother, same.
Why is your translation adding words that are not in the Arabic?
Look, I don't follow the translation here.
You're making your argument from the translation.
Let's say your translation.
Well, let's go with this one then.
Read it slowly, and I'll comment on it.
We'll comment on it together, line for line. So it says...
No, you already commented it.
No.
You read it, I'm going to give it.
No. We're going to give it a commentary together.
I don't have a glasses to read yours.
I'm going to read it for you.
Which one is yours? Translation?
Yusuf Ali.
Okay, I got Yusuf Ali. I'm going to read it. I got Yusuf Ali as well.
Okay.
No problem.
So, while you're finding it, the conditions for fighting the unbeliever is because they don't believe, they don't acknowledge, they don't forbid what's been forbidden, and they don't acknowledge the Prophet. That's the reason to justify the fighting.
Okay, I got Yusuf Ali. Can I read it now?
Yeah, of course you can.
Fight those who believe not in Allah, nor the last day, nor hold that forbidden which hath been forbidden by Allah and his messenger, nor acknowledge the religion of truth of the people of the book. So far is the Jews and the Christians, they are the people of the book, they don't follow the messenger, they don't follow Allah, they don't follow the commands.
So you should fight me, right?
Let me finish the verse. Why are you talking over me? You have an insecurity?
No. You do it.
Are you feeling insecure?
You do it.
So,
not a problem.
Okay, when I done it, what did you call me? Heckler.
I did.
So by that definition, you are heckler as well.
Yes, that's fair.
So what did I, when I came...
It is fair, I am heckling him.
When I came here in the beginning, what did I call him? Hypocrite.
He called me a hypocrite.
Hypocrite. He proved himself that I call him a hypocrite. He is a hypocrite.
Where is the pretense?
You all find out here. So you are a hypocrite.
Shani, continue.
Hypocrite with no name.
Keep going. Anyway, keep going.
So where he ends up, and it says, so talking about the people of the book, until they pay the jizya with willing submission and feel themselves subdued. Now,
do you want to subdue me, Abbas?
Oh, why are you doing that again?
Do you want to subdue
me? I done you heckle once. I heckle you once.
All right.
And I'll answer that as well. I'm a Muslim.
Go on.
I'm not shy of any questions.
Okay,
I'll answer that as well. I want you to pay jizya as well? Basically, the whole point is, these Jews and Christians, if they don't pay jizya, fight them.
Okay.
So if they...
Do you hear that?
No. So Islamic nation, Islamic state. When you build, when you make an Islamic state, an Islamic nation, you follow the laws. Muslims, you pay zakah, and we know that history tells us Abu Bakr fought against the people, those who denied to pay, reject to pay zakah. Muslims, you must pay zakah. If you don't pay zakah, it's going to be fight against you. Christians and Jews, you don't follow Islam, so no zakah for you. You pay jizya. If you don't, we fight you. So all they need to, all they need to do is to pay jizya. And if they are not paying jizya, they are. I haven't finished yet. Basically, they declaring against the state, a war against the state, a rebellion against the state, if they are refusing to pay jizya. So that is my point here. Second point, he says, use the word subdued. Wow, the word used subdued. Do you know what God told David? David went all over the places, and what did he done? Subdued the nations. Not nations. Subdued the nations. So remember, your Bible told us David subdued the nations, a man of God's own heart.
Okay, so he's right. David did subdue the nations. He did defend the people of Israel. He was a great king.
Can you say the way he said subdued?
He was a great king of Israel. Now, let us be clear. Abu Bakr invaded lands that were Christian and imposed Islam upon them.
That is
what he did. And he did that because of verses like this. Notice now he's heckling again. So the point is, here's the thing. I would rather fight you, Abbas, than willingly submit to you. And I would rather fight you than pay the jizya. So what are we going to do? What are we going to do? Do you want to dust up right now? Because I'm not going to submit to Islam. I'm not going to submit to the caliphate. I am not going to pay the jizya. Increasingly, there are more Christians who will refuse to submit to Islam. They will refuse to bow to our caliph. Let me finish. But thank you, Abbas, for admitting I'm right. He said it very clearly. In an Islamic state, those who will not pay the jizya, fight them. So I'm not wrong for pointing out that it is easier to justify violence in the Quran than it is in the Bible, because he just did it very quickly himself. Now, bearing in mind he was accusing me as a hypocrite for pointing out that one was better than the other. Now, I would say this to him. It's interesting he brought up the example of zakat, because what this brings out is the fact that in the very first generation of Muslims, it was not clear that zakat was a pillar of Islam. The Arab confederacies that rebelled against the successor to Muhammad rebelled because they believed that zakat was peculiar to Muhammad's own lifetime and did not apply to his successor. Which means that historically we have evidence that the so-called five pillars of Islam were not clear to the first Muslims.
Source, please.
Which demonstrates your own hadith, which demonstrates that Islam is a later redaction. The Islam that he practices is a later historical construct by a later generation of Muslims that was not clear to the first Muslims. Remember, the Dawah team come around and say, but it wasn't clear. Why don't the church fathers use the word Trinity in the first generation? But yet, we see evidence of the same thing in Islam.
Source, please.
Right, you said source.
Yes.
One, yourself, because you admitted. What were the apostasy laws?
Wow.
What was the apostasy war that happened just after Muhammad died?
Hang on a minute, we're talking about zakah here, yeah? What was the apostasy war? The car was not part of Islam
when
after the Muhammad's death.
Answer my
show
question.
Show me the source.
I am going to.
Until you show me, we're not going to move anywhere.
I'm going to. Yes. No. The hadith.
I want to answer
Islamic,
your question.
Islamic sources, and yes. Any of you can check this.
Hadith.
Any of you can check this. Abbas, stop running away.
I'm demanding your source.
So answer this question. Answer this question very clearly. Okay. Right? After Muhammad died, there was an apostasy by Arab Muslims who refused to pay zakat to the caliph. Yes or no?
You say apostasy? Apostasy?
Yes.
For not paying zakat. How are you complaining?
They refused.
Are you making them both same? Either they didn't pay zakat. They renounce the Islam and they don't pay zakah both.
So when
you renounce the zakah,
he doesn't want to hear.
No, when you do become apostate, zakah doesn't apply on you. So it doesn't make sense if you become apostate and you are refusing to pay zakah, one or the other.
Please notice he didn't actually answer the question.
Did you notice he didn't answer the question?
Let me correct him. According to Islamic jurisprudence, if a Muslim refuses to pay zakat, they are considered an apostate. I am not making that up. That's what Islamic jurisprudence states.
You should say that.
That is a fact.
You should say that.
Incidentally, a later construct. So when these Muslim Arabs refused to pay zakat, they were considered apostates, and the Muslims fought against them as apostates. Not as Muslims, as apostates. So I will ask you again, Abbas.
There is a conflicting argument.
I will ask you again, Abbas.
Either they were not apostates.
Here is my question.
They were not apostates, but they refused to pay zakat.
They weren't doing it because they were stingy. They were doing it because they were refused.
They were doing it because they were stingy.
No.
Because they don't want to pay it.
Thank you. They did not want to pay it. He admits it. So I'm not making it up. There you go. That's my evidence. Thank you. Thank you very much.
What's the evidence?
You've just admitted it.
No. Don't play games like that.
I'll ask you again.
You're talking too much.
Answer this question directly.
Is that what you think?
Right, I'll give you a question and then you can come in. Here's the question.
Talk a lot.
Did
people start believing
Muslims in the first century of Islam refuse to pay the zakat, and is that why they were fought by other Muslims?
That was not your claim. You said earlier, after the death of Muhammad, the zakah was not part of the religion.
That is my evidence to the point.
No. Then you say it's a hadith about it.
You've not followed the argument.
I want you to show me the hadith.
You've not followed the argument.
I want you to show me the hadith where zakah was not considered part
of
the religion.
So
there were some.
There
were some people who didn't want to pay zakah. They were vegan faith. They were stingy because it's a possession.
No. Brother, that wasn't the reason they gave.
I am saying, what are you talking about?
Islamic sources don't give that reason.
You can refute me in your own time.
You've been talking over me the whole time, Abbas. Don't whinge now.
So this is how we're going to do it?
It looks like it.
Toby, I'm not going to play this game.
Right.
Because this is very cheap shot, really. I'm talking, then you're just talking over me.
And you're not.
Let's say now, I'm not going to talk over you, you're not going to talk over me. How about that?
Okay. Can we have a timer?
No, we don't
have
a timer. We don't have a timer. I don't talk a lot like you. No. I make a short point.
What was that about cheap shots?
Yes.
What was that about cheap shots?
What cheap shots?
Anyway, carry on.
Yeah, okay. So, point here was, I almost forgot the point. Okay, you're going to show me the hadith. The hadith says that the zakah was not part of the religion after Muhammad died. That's what was your claim. I want you to show me that source. So if you can't show me the source, it's all proof. There were some people who were misled for their worldly love of the world, for the possessions. So they say they didn't pay zakah. That doesn't mean that got out of the religion. That was not part of the religion. Secondly, actually, I wanted to answer this question. Would you make me pay jizya?
Yeah, was your question. Would you want me to pay jizya in willing submission?
Such a false implication. You thinking that wherever Muslims go, they should force Christians or non-Muslims to pay jizya? No, this is not how it works. It works like this. When people decided to to make a country a Sharia law, apply Sharia law. Sharia law only apply where the majority of people are Muslim and they agree with it. It's a democracy. If they agree with the Sharia law, in that law, if you decided to live in that country as a Jew or a Christian, it's your decision. You can leave the country. But if you decided to leave in that country, you must pay jizya. And I'm going to give an example.
You might not... going to talk and talk?
You know, can I reply? For 30 more seconds.
Okay.
I'm going to give you an extreme example. For example, in this country, eventually become Muslim, majority. 80-90% become Muslim. And inshallah it will. When become Muslim, and Muslims decided by themselves, we love Sharia law. We want Sharia law to apply in this country, not by force, but by democracy. We want Sharia law. If the majority decided it, then all the Jews and Christians, they supposed to pay jizya. If not,
eventually
it will become illegal,
and eventually and they
will be persecuted. So this is my answer to you. If that happens,
may I reply
then,
now, Abbas?
Then you should pay jizya.
So let's just be clear. Abbas presents this. Abbas presents this. And
I'm let, happy with who
brother,
I am.
Brother,
That's fine. Nobody forcing you to become Muslim. But you are welcome to become Muslim anytime.
So Abbas presents this like it's some kind of option. Historically, it was not an option. What happened were Muslims invaded lands that were not their own and imposed this upon people. And that happened for 1400 years. That's the reality of history. So Abbas's characterization that this is the free movement of people, a free choice, it's simply designed to make Islam look appealing. Look at the history. If Abbas is saying that this should just be done peacefully, then he has to condemn the four rightly guided caliphs who did not do this, who imposed Islam by force on others. And if you don't believe me, go and ask the Coptic Christians, go and ask the Syrian Christians, go and ask the Greek Christians, go and ask the Armenian Christians. There are plenty of testimonies to be heard. Now, he said that show me the hadith where it says that this is an option. He did not follow my argument carefully. We're talking about zakat. What I am pointing out is that the Islamic sources show that after the death of Muhammad, there was a rebellion of Arab Muslims against the caliph. They refused to pay the zakat because they understood that the zakat was particular and specific to the lifetime of Muhammad, not a continuing obligation. Now, that means that the first Muslims, having lived in the presence of the Prophet, didn't understand that zakat was a pillar of Islam. There was a dispute amongst the Muslims. They fought one another, and one group accused the other group of being apostates. That's why it's called the War of Apostasy. I'm not saying that the hadiths teach that it is an option. Of course, the hadiths written 200 years later, long after Muhammad was dead, characterized the Islam Abbas is supporting. I am demonstrating that therefore the first generation of Muslims, soon the first generation of Muslims, were not clear about zakat. And the Dawah team go around the corner speaking to Christians, demanding, well, why didn't the church fathers use the word Trinity? Why didn't they talk about it clearly, etc., etc., etc.? Well, their logic can be reversed. Islam was not clear from the time of Muhammad, and I have other examples that I can give.
Anyway,
your reply.
Okay, so if you say those people, it was not clear enough for them. The zakah was obligatory. So you actually saying, you know, it's Islam's fault, it was not clear enough. Quran tells us again and again, pay zakah, waqimu salata wa atu zakata. So many times it's repetitive, so many times in the Quran. So if they misunderstood it, it's their fault. Same way, if Jews misunderstood Jesus, he was not Messiah, it's not the fault of the God or the Messiah, it's their fault. So these people who didn't pay zakah, is their fault, it's not a fault of Islam. That was the point I wanted to, I forgot so many points you make. Remind me what point you make.
So we talked about Zakat.
Oh yes, about the IS actually says it's so peaceful. It's just an option for people. About jizya, it's an option for people. I never made that point, you know that. I was telling, give you an example in this country. If everybody become Muslim, majority, and they decided it.
May I ask a question? Yeah.
No, that was the, I never say when that took place with Jews and Christians. I didn't say there was an option for them. It was not. It was a context. There was a context. It was the battle with the Romans was upon them. And then Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam went in the north of Arabia. And there were Jews and Christians living there. And there were rumors. They are the one who's going to side the Romans. And many people, if you read the hadith and the biographies, they tell you, and the commentaries, they tell you, these people were saying the Romans are going to come and teach you a lesson, you Muslims. Then Muslims have to show the authority who is the authority here, and we are not going to be afraid of anybody. So if you are on their side, we tell you, we are your leaders, you pay us jizya. So don't threaten us about Romans. So if there's a context to that. So I am never claiming that was the option for those people at that time. But I was giving you an example. In this time, if Sharia law comes, there will be option, live here or pay jizya.
May I reply?
Leave or pay jizya.
May I reply?
I forgot other points.
May I reply?
So I think we're going to make a point, and then we're going to do, because
okay.
I told you,
okay.
I came here to expose you, you're a hypocrite, which you actually proved you're a hypocrite.
People
but if you want to have a debate with me,
so
any time, any debate, we can have a debate, no problem.
May I reply? So Abbas, notice. He admits, and nor does he deny, that Muslims invaded other lands. And let's be clear, they didn't just invade Christian lands. They invaded Persian lands. What threat were the Persians? They didn't just invade Persia. They invaded Afghanistan. What threat were the Afghanis? They didn't just invade Afghanistan. They invaded India. What threat were the Hindus? They invaded North Africa. What threat were the Christians of Spain? They weren't even in the Roman Empire at the time that the Muslims invaded. So the argument that the Islamic invasion of other lands was justified because of some threat by those Christians to the Muslims is a fallacious lie of the worst kind. A fallacious lie of an imperialist ideology that seeks to subjugate the world to its backward system of laws. And I will not submit. So therefore, Abbas has a choice in this future hypothetical world. He can kill me, fight me, banish me. But he's going to have to do one of those things, because in the hypothetical world that he's talking about, I will not pay the jizya with willing submission, and neither should you. And don't think that this is just hypothesis. Demographically, the West is collapsing because liberalism is a cancer on our society. And demographically, as these guys well know, and so do I, and as many of you also know, it is quite conceivable that simply through birth rate, the majority religions will change in the West. So you will also be faced a choice if this comes about. And if people like Abbas are the ones deciding things for the Muslim community. And let's be clear, not all Muslims will. Because many Muslims actually don't really practice Islam beyond the cultural level. And they're quite peaceable. So when Abbas characterized me as being, oh, wherever Muslims go, they're seeking to impose Islam. It says that the Messiah will rule in the presence, in the hearts of his enemies. The kingdom of God is in Mecca. The kingdom of God is in Medina. There are Muslims who have converted to the Christian faith and are practicing it inside Saudi Arabia. So by the will of God, like we are seeing in Iran, Islam will crumble as the kingdom of God expands in Muslim worlds. We don't have to follow a narrative of defeat. We simply have to follow a narrative of a more muscular Christian faith. You can have the final word.
Yeah, there's just 3 points I'd like to make. First of all, when he says that Abbas can kill me, fight me, or banish me if he take over.
In the hypothetical world.
Yeah. He's using that verse of chapter
29.
Surah 9:29. Now, when Allah says fight doesn't always mean kill. For example, when you fight for your rights, are you killing people? No. It's a struggle. You can fight. Nowadays, if you, you don't pay jizya, you're going to be put in the prison. Not you're going to be killed as well. That's the first point I like to make. Secondly, as a hypocrite, I believe he is, in the Bible, David subdued nations. He slaughtered nations by the order of God, those who were not following the command of God. So if God, why Allah cannot do that, and Islam cannot do that, if they want to spread religion, if it happened in the past. And second, and thirdly, I want to say, when Muslims go and fight, you say Hindus and Afghanis and all that, Allah told us to go and spread the message of Islam. When you got the message of Islam.
There you go.
You spread the message of Islam.
Thank you, Allah.
Which what we believe is the truth, message of Islam. There's one God, there's the messengers, then angels, and then they do the right things. Do charity. You know, the, be a righteous be a righteous human being. But
invade their countries.
But spread the message. But if anybody come on your way and tell you you cannot come and spread the message, what
you
we
can,
why look, I didn't speak when you were talking.
Fair enough. I hear that. Go on.
So when as a Muslim we go, Allah told us every human being have a right to know who the true God is. They have a right. There's their birthright. So we Muslims have to go and tell them. But if somebody come on your way, then you do jihad. You struggle and you strive against those evil forces who are stopping you to come and bring the truth. So that happened in the past. Khulafa Rashidin or Khalifa, they done. They went, they say, we want to bring a message. They say, you can't. Okay, then we're going to fight you to get to those people who need to hear the message. But that doesn't happen everywhere. In Indonesia, a country like Indonesia, the biggest Muslim country in the world, no Muslim army went there. It's only Muslims went there, the traders went there, they spread the word of mouth, they spread the word of Islam, and they became Muslim. There was no need to fight those people. But if any Hindus came on the way, they say, you are not allowed. Why are you afraid of the truth? We're going to go in there, even if we have to use force, we go to go in there. But in Islam, it says that. But if they don't fight, many times it says in the Quran, but if they don't fight and they want peace, give them peace. So if nobody's fighting against you, don't fight against them. You can spread the, let us spread the message of Islam in a peaceful way. But I'm not saying that this happened now, when in the time of Khulafa Rashidin, there people need to hear the truth. Now all the world knows the truth through internet. You can give them dawah through internet. Nobody can stop you. So there is no reason to fight physically anymore. Dawah, nobody can stop dawah now. So that time, dawah can only reach if you reach physically. If somebody stop you, you fight. So that's where the wars and fights took place. And I think that's the end of it. Or you want to take the last word? No.
I'm just going to say, you know, look after yourself. But what we've just heard from Abbas is an Islamic justification for invading other countries. That's what we heard.
Invading hearts, actually.
Invading other countries. We were talking in historical terms about invading other countries. And then remember what Abbas said at the beginning. Remember how he was trying to say that I was a hypocrite. I'm not saying Abbas is a hypocrite. He's being very honest.
You can say that.
I'm not going to. He's being very honest about what Islam really teaches. Those of you, those of your political leaders, those apologists who come forward and say, no, Islam is not about being spread by the sword. Listen to Abbas, because Abbas knows his religion better than Theresa May, David Cameron, Angela Merkel, Macron, and all those other liberal, progressive, virtue signaling hypocrites and apologists who try to say that Islam was never spread by the sword and that Islam is a religion of peace. Abbas just gave you the Islamic justification for invading Afghanistan and India and Persia and the Roman Christian Empire. Why? Because they won't let us bring our religion to them. Because they resist us bringing our religion to them, we will invade their lands to bring it. That was his logic. You all heard it himself. I was not lying when I said there are easier routes to violence in Islam than in Christianity.
It doesn't apply now, as I told you.
In a hypothetical world. Thank you.
In a hypothetical world, Abbas, let us just imagine.
I think we've done that.
Yeah, we have. I'll let you go if you want to. I'm not going to hold you.
But maybe another couple of minutes I have to go, but I don't want to carry on.
But in our hypothetical world...
If you want to have a proper debate on some subject, I'd love to have
it. In our hypothetical world, where 90% of Britain is Muslim,
yes,
and they want to bring in Sharia,
yes,
I absolutely will not pay jizya. I won't pay it with willing submission.
Are you going to go Holloway prison or Pentonville prison?
Are you going to imprison me or are you going to kill me?
If I'm the authority, no, why kill? Why kill?
What's the...
In those times, there were no prisons there.
What?
There was no prison. So how you control the enemy? So only the way you
control the enemy,
you kill them.
Right,
but nowadays, you put them in the prison.
Okay, hold on 1 second. What is the prophetic precedent for prisons?
Say that again.
What is the prophetic tradition for prisons?
Remind me. I don't get your question.
Well,
really.
you would agree with me that Islam is about following the Sunnah, right? So you follow what Muhammad did, right? So show me, because you're trying to argue that you just threw me in, just put me in prison. The command of Allah, as interpreted by Muhammad's life. So what is the precedent for the justification of prisons in Islam?
When Islam nowadays, when people do something wrong, they put them in the prison.
Did Muhammad do that?
There were no prisons in his time, do you know that?
Why?
There were no prisons.
Exactly.
What happened, that's what the slavery...
I accept there wasn't.
That's what the slavery was there, because either you put them in the prison, but there was no prison, so what do? You keep them in your home, and then that's what the
slave trade?
No, in the war. When the slavery, prisoners of war.
You enslave them, yes.
You take them at home.
Yes.
But then, when they were in prisons, then they put them in the prison. In the Ottoman empires, they put them in the prison.
Abbas, I am not denying that the Muslim world...
So this is the precedence of...
My point to you is, because you didn't really address my question, my point to you is, Muslims are here week in, week out, saying, Muhammad is the best example, follow the example of Muhammad,
yes,
we do the sunnah of Muhammad, yes. We follow what Muhammad did,
yes.
Right? So, in the 21st century, Muhammad never had any prisons. This is a Christian concept. It is a Christian innovation. And we have no problem with such innovation, because it's more merciful to imprison someone than just to kill them all the time. It was a development that came out of the Christian world. So what is your justification Islamically for the institution of a prison system if it is not bidah? And bidah is a sin.
How come it's a bidah? How come it's a bidah?
Is a bidah doing something that Muhammad did not do?
Oh, we flying planes.
What was the crusade for?
Look, we fly planes.
One topic at a time. Oh, look, it's my heckler here.
Christian doesn't
You'll get your chance.
So you are basically saying Muhammad Sassan used to ride a horse and a donkey or a camel. So we are driving cars, that's a bidah?
I wouldn't call that bidah.
Yeah, so anything which the Islam doesn't oppose, we are allowed to do that. Islam, show me anywhere in Islam it opposes you, we should not have a prison.
Okay, so show me this concept in Muhammad's own words.
Huh?
Show me a hadith where Muhammad justifies this.
No, you show me where it says you can't have a prison.
Wait a minute, aren't you doing dawah?
What are you doing?
You're doing dawah,
no,
right?
No. I'm asking you a question about Islam. I'm answering your illogical question with the logic that where Islam says you cannot do that, and then we are doing it. Then it goes bidah. Bidah is when you go something against Islam. And this, you know, having a prison is not a part of Islam and not Islam. What is Islam is, you know, the rituals of Islam. Prisons are the things of the states. You are allowed to do that. That is not part
Islam
of Islam. That is not part of the religion.
Is bidah on bidah on bidah. There is no hadith. Islam is bidah on bidah on bidah. Islam has... There's no command in the Quran to have a collection of hadiths. There's no command in the Quran to form Islamic schools. There's no Quran. There's no. I'm not going to do a Mansour and say he's running away. Yeah, I'm not going to do that.
You can.
You've had a good debate.
Do you want to have? I'll challenge you to have a debate on justice in the Bible and in the Quran. Which book teach justice? You want to have a debate with me next week?
Yeah, that's absolutely fine.
Yeah? Justice in April. Yeah,
that's absolutely fine.
We'll do that next week.
Yep, that's absolutely fine. So where's my heckler? Come here.
You can lie without me.
Every single week you heckle me.
Keep lying.
Every single week. I want to ask. I want to ask you a question about Mohammed.
Are you ready?
I want to ask you a question about Mohammed.